how do you extract meaning from text-based data? And by text-based data, I mean interview and focus group scripts or secondary sources like online customer reviews. In this video, I'm going to go through the process, focusing on identifying what we call nuances in the data. I'll start by explaining what qualitative research is about and what nuances are. And I'll then explain the process by resorting to an example from a dissertation that I recently supervised. Many times, my students have collected great qualitative data, but the analysis is a bit of a letdown. Or in other words, it does not make justice to the data collected. And one of the main reasons is a lack of understanding of what is expected when analyzing data. When your tutors look at your qualitative data analysis chapter, they look for two things. The first is the level of theorization. The second expectation is that you demonstrate your ability to extract detailed meaning, and this is done by identifying nuances. In this video, you are going to learn how to fulfill the two expectations with an emphasis on identifying nuances. There is more detailed content about how to develop your abstract thinking skills in the Video Tutor online resource. Before we move on to look at the case study, which will help you to understand how the process unfolds, it's important to go back to the purpose of qualitative research. And the purpose of this type of research is to describe and explain the social world and to develop explanatory models and theories that could help us understand that social world and in particular the specific phenomenon that we are interested in. And embedded in this purpose is the need to look at it in a lot of detail because we are using qualitative research based on the assumption that there is not a lot known about that phenomenon and therefore we want to know as much as we can about it. So the essence of qualitative research is detail, and the more detail about the phenomenon we can understand, the better, if anything, because the more detailed the explanatory model and theory is going to be. And you can't do that without looking at nuances in the data. What is a nuance? A nuance is a subtle difference in meaning or expression. And this is vital for qualitative research because, as I said before, what we are trying to understand when we apply qualitative research is the detail, a good level of detail that allows us to develop a comprehensive understanding of the phenomenon that we are researching. So understanding nuances and how to identify them and structure them in a coherent framework is very important, and it's what this video is about. The process that we are going to follow in this video involves three steps. In step one, you are expected to identify the main categories or the main themes in your data. Once you've done that, you move on to identify subcategories or sub-themes. And you do that until you exhaust all possibilities. In other words, until you identify all the nuances, all the subtle differences in the data. And once you've developed your framework, you can carry out what I call the abstraction test to check how good your analytical framework, basically the structure of your themes, is. I won't cover this in this video. I do cover it in the Virtual Tutor online resource. The example for this video comes from a dissertation on constraints to attend protests. And there are three objectives. The first one is to examine the intrapersonal constraints to attend protests. The second one is to examine the interpersonal constraints to attend protests. And the third one is to examine the structural constraints to attend protests. In this example, I'm going to focus on one of them, and it's on objective three. So the three bits of information that I'm going to bring in so that we can analyze them with a view to identify nuances relates to one type of structural constraints. Before we look at the three bits of information that we are going to work with, it's important to define what a structural constraint or structural barrier is. And according to the formal definition, a structural barrier is a constraint factor that can arise between a person's leisure preference and participation. So basically, are those more tangible reasons as to why you are unable to participate in the leisure activity, in this instance, attend an event. There's another author, Crawford and Godby, who provide examples of the types of structural constraints. And they give as examples financial resources, availability of time, knowledge, life cycle. And these are just examples. Actually, the one that we are going to look at is a different type of structural constraint. Let's start with the step one, which is identifying the main themes within the broad theme of structural constraints. And the first bit of text that comes from the interviews that the student carried out reads as, I do remember on the tube when I was going into London, they had blocked off quite a lot of the tube stops. So my plan for where I was planning to get off on the tube, they just didn't stop there because of the protests. And I remember that in the end, I didn't get there on time. So the key theme here is transportation. The participant is talking about a barrier, a structural barrier that refers to the transportation element. And if we try to identify the type of transportation barrier that is at play, we can actually conclude that this type of transportation constraint or barrier is related to the protest itself. The constraint was generated, was caused by the protest. Because there were protests, the police changed the mobility patterns in London, and this person was able to attend the protest as expected because of that disruption. If we were to pick up on this theme and move it to our bulleted point structure, this is how it could look like. So we have our main theme, which is structural constraints. From here, we identify that within structural constraints, there are transportation constraints. And within transportation constraints, we identified protest-related travel constraints. And we also provide a brief definition of it so that we know exactly what these protest-related travel constraints refer to. The second bit of text coming from the interviews reads as, I didn't have a car and public transport would have been over a couple of hours and involved two changes. So it just wasn't in my close to me for me, so I didn't go. Clearly, this is not about the previous theme that we identified, protest-related constraints. We must come up with a new label that defines the type of transportation constraint that this statement embodies. What would you come up with? What type of transportation constraint would you identify here? In our case, we identified it as a personal transportation constraint. And we labeled it personal transportation constraint because it's about the person not having a car and therefore having to resort to public transportation if he or she wants to go to the protest. So the cause of the constraint is about the person. It's not about the protest, but about the person. Let's add this to our bulleted point structure, and therefore we can add a second sub-theme of transportation constraints called personal travel constraints, and we define these as constraints related to the person or the protester, since we are looking at protesters here. The third bit of text reads as, I didn't go to the protests. That required traveling to London, and it was like the height of COVID. There was a preventative travel between me and the protest, since public transport was only for work. So you should have been only using public transport to get to work, and obviously I wasn't doing that. The first question that we need to ask is it the same theme as the previous two themes? In my view, it isn't. We've got here a third theme. So what we have to do is to identify the substance of this bit of text and then give it a label that reflects that substance. And the label that we gave to this bit of text is third-party imposed transportation constraints. So these three bits of text actually refer to three types of transportation constraints. If we add this theme to our bulleted point structure, this is how it looks like. Some of you may have picked up the fact that these two constraints can be aggregated into a common category. And that common category is non-protest related constraints. So we've got one category, the first one that we identified, protest-related travel constraints. And actually, there's something that brings together the other two categories. And that something is the fact that they are not protest or they are non-protest-related constraints. Another point to add at this stage is that we've got a four-level structure. We've got level one, the broadest one, are the structural barriers. Level two are the transportation constraints. Then we've got two themes within level three, protest-related and non-protest-related constraints. And then within the latter, we have two types of constraints, personal travel constraints and third-party imposed constraints. So we've got a very neat structure here. But I don't know if you picked up, there is still a lot of meaning that we haven't included here. And that's what step two is about. It's to look at more nuances within each of these themes. Let's go back to the three quotes that we are working with and see what additional meaning we can find. If we look at the first one, the question that we are asking is, what sorts of protest-related constraints, specific protest-related constraints, can we identify? And if we read the text again, one possible take on it is that the type of protest-related constraint being addressed by this participant is station closures and more specifically, tube station closures. If we move to the second one, the personal-related constraints, the question is the same. What specific personal-related constraints can we identify in this quote? In this instance, there are actually two personal-related constraints, and they are no own means of transportation. The person hasn't got a car, but also inconvenient public transportation. If we move to the third one, third-party constraints, we identify that there's one specific third-party constraint expressed in this quote. And that specific constraint can be referred to as government-imposed restrictions. So what we have managed to do here is go even deeper in our analysis, identifying more detailed nuances in the data, the shades, the little subtle variations in the data, and we can add this to our structure. So this is how it looks like before we did this exercise, and this is how it will look like once we embed the additional meaning that we have extracted. But it's not over yet. We can even identify more nuances. Before we do so, if you're enjoying the video, press the like button, and if you're not subscribed, subscribe to the channel and hit the bell button so that you're notified every time we release a new video. So what additional meaning can we identify? Let's go back to the second statement that we are working with. And it's a statement about personal related constraints, and we identified two personal related constraints so far. But actually the statement gives us more information that we should identify and capture. And the information is about the constraint inconvenient public transportation. The question is the same. What types of inconvenience can we identify? The first one is related to the length of the trip. So the participant said public transport would have been over a couple of hours. So the theme that we can identify is the duration of the trip. It's inconvenient because of the duration. The second type of inconvenience is that it involves two changes and a possible label, and these are our labels, so they will be your labels as long as they are fair and they make justice to the data. No one will challenge them. The label that we came up with was the routes that the public transportation follows. It's just too inconvenient. There are too many changes which act as a barrier to use public transportation. So what we've done here, and we can go back to our bulleted point structure, and we can add this additional meaning. Within the inconvenient public transportation, we have two bullet points, and they are duration and routes. So what we ended up with is a six-level framework. We had a 4-1 at the end of stage one or step one, we had a 4-level framework. Now we have a 6-level framework. We've got structural as level one, we've got transportation as level two, We've got two at level three, the protest-related and non-protest-related constraints. We've got three at level four. We've got three at level five. And we've got two themes at level six, the last two that we identified. For your convenience, this shows the structure according to each level. So as you can see, by looking at the nuances, we managed to squeeze so much data from three participant quotes. So focus on developing your skills to read and interpret the quotes, the relevant quotes that you identify. And once you do that, you need to develop your skills of identifying the theme and labeling it. How can we be sure that our analytical structure is good? One possible way is to run it through what I call the abstraction test. I explained this test in the Video Tutor online resource and apply the explanation to the example we covered in this video. There are a lot of more videos in this channel with great tips and tools to help you write a better dissertation, including this one. Thank you for watching, and I'll see you at the next video.